Hey Wonder Lab crew, my name is Jaren and I was a volunteer assistant from 2007 to 2010 when I was a student at IU, and I just wanted to say just how important and impactful it was, my experience at Wonder Lab, and making sure that I had a career where I could have fun and also be impactful, and also where I could work at a place that has a cool apron. So I just want to say thank you for everybody for forming my career and making sure that I love my job. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Cassie Johnston, and I was a Wonder Lab marketing intern from 2003 through 2005. And the skills I learned being part of the Wonder Lab team directly impacted where I was throughout my career and eventually helped me get to where I am now, which is owner of my own company. I run my own digital publishing company. I think what was so wonderful about my time at Wonder Lab was, since this team was so small and tight-knit, everyone had to wear a ton of different hats, and it meant that I got to learn skills that were outside of what I was learning in the classroom. It was practical stuff about how to work within a budget, work within a timeline, work with a group of people, work with the public. And those are all the kind of skills that, when I went into my first job interview after college, the people interviewing me were incredibly impressed that I could hit the ground running, because those are the kind of skills that not everyone was coming out of college with. And so those kind of skills, those practical skills were able to really jump me forward in my career, get me to the point where I could start my own business. And I am just eternally grateful for my time at Wonder Lab. I had so much fun. I consider everyone their friends, and I look back at my time just super incredibly fondly, and I'm so grateful I took that first day and went and did that internship. It was just an absolutely wonderful experience for me personally and for my career.
Hello and welcome to Science Night Out. I hope you all are enjoying yourselves this evening. My name is Carly Fields and I am a fiber artist and clothing designer, and I'm here to talk to you tonight about a temperature blanket. We currently have one for our silent auction tonight that I made for Bloomington specifically for 2019. The one I have right now that I'm going to show you is currently 2020 temperature blanket. So the idea behind a temperature blanket is to create a visual representation of a set of data. The data chosen is the average daily temperature in a given location. So the one I'm working on right now actually does the high and the low of each day. So each color represents 12 degrees, and I have 9 colors in this blanket. So what that kind of looks like close up, we have one stripe that is all blue, and that means both colors that I chose, the high and the low, are between 28 and 39 degrees. So you can see kind of the homogeneity that happens there. Right next to it, the day before, is a yellow and blue stripe. And so that signifies that that day had a variance of about 40 degrees. So when it all comes together, you get a really interesting visual representation of Bloomington throughout its weather. Now, what I love about these kinds of projects is that it marries art and science. We're often given this idea of a false dichotomy, that you have arts over here and you have science over here. But what's really interesting and beautiful is when you can take that science and turn it into a beautiful piece of art. I think we're better together. We use all of our skills to create something beautiful. And it's even better when you can take your artwork at the end of the day and snuggle up underneath it.
Hi, everybody. I'm Beth Raff. I'm the Vice President of the Wonder Lab Board of Directors. And I'm here today to show you the process for bidding in the silent auction using your phone. We all have our phones. And between you and me, I think they picked me to show you how to do this. Because if I can do it, you can too. Okay, so when you signed up, when you got your ticket to the gala, you will have gotten a text from GiveSmart, the company that's doing the helping support the gala. And so go to that thread, and the thread is entitled by the number, it comes from 762-778. So click on that thread, and then the first text you got thanks you for getting your ticket, and you can, it gives you a link if you want more details about the gala. And that would be great to click on, but the second text is the one we're talking about today. So, and that says, starting September 2, the Gala Silent Auction is now open for Wonder Lab. And so go to that link, it will appear on your phone, and you'll start seeing items. For instance, in the right-hand corner is a Trek bike and accessories. And I wanna tell you, the silent auction items are just terrific. So look at them all before you decide what to bid on, and then bid on lots of them. Okay, so now you can scroll down. Just once you're on that screen, you're really home free, because any item that you wish to bid on, just touch it, goes to the link to that, and you can enter your bid. But there are a few more wrinkles that we can look at. So once you get here to the items, as you scroll down, pretty soon you'll come to a logo for one of our sponsors. And the logos of our sponsors sort of appear and in different rotation or orders in here, because we want to thank our sponsors. And so as you scroll by those links, give a thanks to our sponsors. They're great. So, but when you get to that first sponsor logo, don't quit scrolling, because there's more items under. And keep going down and down and down. We have lots of items in the silent auction. And I'll just keep scrolling till you get to the very bottom. I'm just going to say one more thing. When you get to the bottom, there are green bands across that are like filters, so you can see different categories of items. As for example, the very last category is Tasty Treats. So let's try that one. We go to Tasty Treats, and that pops up the four wonderful Tasty Treats that you can bid on in the silent auction. But then you always have the choice of going back to all items. So we're looking forward to seeing you, even if in 2D, at the gala. And please don't forget, keep bidding in the silent auction. Thanks, bye. Thank you.
sounded really nice.
Thank you.
You know what I really like about the trumpet?
What's that?
I like the way that when you blow air in, it activates a standing wave inside the bent tubing of the instrument, and that produces the sound that comes out of the bell. Would you like some lemonade?
Sure.
How about a little tea in your lemonade?
Of course.
I have this nice dark blue tea here.
Oh, that's pretty.
That's chemistry.
My name is Sarah Lynn Wells, and I'm a museum educator at Wonder Lab Museum. Today I'm going to show you an activity that you can do at home with just a couple of items to experiment with sound waves. The first thing you want to do is go to your kitchen and grab a spoon. Doesn't matter, you could do something as small as a teaspoon or as large as a ladle. You just want to make sure it's a metal spoon. Next, check your swag box and you should have some twine. We're going to attach this to our spoons. So what I'm going to do, if you have a spoon that has some sort of cutout or opening on the handle, it makes it really easy. You can just thread that right through. Mine doesn't have that, so I'm going to show you a really easy way to go ahead and attach that twine to your spoon. I have it folded in half, so it makes a nice little loop here. I'm just going to carefully pull the other end through. Sometimes if you do it too quickly, it starts to pull off of the spoon. But once I tighten it, it makes it to where I've got a nice connection there, and it's gonna hold on to my spoon. So now I have some twine with a metal spoon attached. So now you wanna make sure that you are near some sort of hard surface. I'm sitting at a table, so this is perfect for our activity. You could also use the back of a chair or something else like that. You just want to make sure it's a metal spoon and it's hitting against a hard surface. All right, so what we're going to do now is I am going to wrap the ends of my twine. It doesn't have to be at the very end, but I'm going to wrap it around my pointer finger a few times. I just want to make sure I've wrapped that twine around my finger a few different times. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put my fingers in my ear. Much like putting some headphones in, and I'm going to gently tap my spoon against the hard surface. Like I said, I've got a table right here, so that works perfectly. But you want to make sure as you are hitting the spoon against the hard surface, you're keeping your fingers attached in your ear. Now, you might have been able to hear the spoon hitting against the table, but you can't hear exactly what I was hearing. When you do that, you're probably familiar with what a spoon is going to sound like against a table. But when you do it that way, you're going to hear something very different. What you are hearing and experiencing through this experiment is learning a little bit more about sound waves. Now, you may know that sound waves are due to vibration. When that spoon is hitting that hard surface, there's a vibration, and that creates sound and that we end up hearing. Sound waves typically travel through the air. But in this experiment, the spoon, when it begins to vibrate against the hard surface, it begins to have vibration. That vibration continues through the string and through your finger into your ear. So rather than hearing the sound from sound waves that are traveling through the air, you are actually hearing the sound by sound waves and vibration that's traveling through the string. And it's really interesting because sound waves travel differently through a solid than they do through a gas like the air. So this is a great way to see the difference between what it sounds like if I hit this spoon against the table and hear that vibration through the air, through the sound waves traveling through the air, versus if I hear that through the sound traveling through the string. So just a great way to hear the difference between how sound waves travel through solids versus through gases.
So what do you guys love about Wonder Lab?
Snakes! Oh, my favorite thing, my really, really favorite thing, it's the where you get to put the animals in the basket and then reel them up.
Oh yeah, in the kids' play area.
Yeah, I like that too, and I like the big bubble thing.
The giant bubble maker?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
And then I also like the water table with all the little fountains. Because I like to put my fingers up against the glass cut and then let the water run down my fingers.
Oh.
What is science?
Science is the study of everything and how everything works.
What I like most about science is without it, anybody would barely know anything. And I guess what I like about Wonder Lab is the fossil dig. And in Wonder Lab, they can teach you a bunch of cool stuff. And they have a bunch of fun stuff like mazes and dinosaur digs. And it's very fun.
We need science to cure diseases like COVID. They'll find a vaccine sometime soon, I just know it. At Wonder Lab in Bloomington, I know you'll have a fun time. All it takes to love it is just to go one time.
Greetings from Wonder Lab. I'm Karen Jepson Ennis, Executive Director, and I couldn't be happier to welcome you to Wonder Lab's Science Night In Gala Fundraiser, The Sound of Science. When I was thinking about what to say to you this evening, it kept coming back to just one word, gratitude. I am so grateful that Wonder Lab is open again so that we can hear the sounds of kids playing on our exhibits and see those families who tell us over and over again that their kids wake up every morning and say they want to go to Wonder Lab to learn about science. I'm so grateful to our staff who have found many creative ways to connect with our community during the time we were closed. From serving over 500 families through online programming, to writing 5 new federal partnership grants with our IU research partners, to serving 40 teachers this summer at our Summer Teacher Institute. I'm grateful for all of those generous grants, loans, and donations that helped us keep our awesome staff, make changes to our building and our operations, and challenges ahead. Due to the COVID shutdown and the loss of revenue during our busiest and most profitable season, we're projected to end the year with a funding gap of $143,000. That's a really big number. So our goal tonight is to put a big dent in that number so that Wonder Lab can keep helping kids be passionate learners and become curious, creative problem solvers, because we'll need them for the future. So now, check your phones and bid high and often on all of the amazing things tonight, and have fun.
Hello, my name is Irene Newton, and I am an associate professor of biology at Indiana University in Bloomington. In my laboratory, we study host-microbe interactions, how microbes interact with their hosts and change their biology. This is something especially relevant to think about right now. In this moment, the entire world has discovered that a small bit of RNA can have a devastating effect on our economies and on our health, causing phenomenal devastation. The microbes I study in my lab are those that are beneficial to their hosts, that provide them with nutrients, and that protect them from invading pathogens. As a scientist, what has drawn me to science is the ability to make observations about the world, to form a hypothesis grounded in those observations, and to perform controlled experiments to test that hypothesis. And in that moment, when I analyze the data for the first time and discover something new, a new result, that moment is one in which I am the only person in the world with that secret knowledge. It's that feeling of discovery that drew me to science and that keeps me in science. That wonder that I felt as a young student discovering something new about the world around me is what drew me to science and what has kept me in it. And this is what Wonder Lab does for our kids every day. The moments of discovery that kids experience at Wonder Lab help them to appreciate and understand how science plays a role in their everyday lives. It is not something separate, it is not something apart, but indeed central to their life. For example, the technology that powers their class, their fermentative microbes that make the cheese on their pizza, even the eusocial insect that makes the honey for their breakfast. All these things are science. We need museums, especially science museums, now more than ever. These museums educate and cultivate critical thinking skills that allow us and our kids to identify what is real and what is not. This is an especially important skill in our current times. Let us support Wonder Lab and teach our kids to think for themselves and to inspire them to tackle the biggest problems facing our society now. Thank you for listening to me, and thank you for your support of Wonder Lab.
I'm here today with the Wonder Lab beehive, and I'm hearing lots of buzzing coming from the colony. Now, bees make this noise by beating their wings at speeds of up to 200 times every single second. These noisy vibrations are helpful for an essential ecological role that bees play. But for that, we're gonna have to head outside to the Wonder Garden.
Bees are incredibly important pollinators, and when visiting flowers, some bees utilize the sound waves coming off of their beating wings to shake off extra pollen. The pollen lands on the bee's body and is transported to the next flower that the bee lands on, utilizing sound to create new life.
Hunter Miller turns out to be a really great video personality, although we didn't hire him for that job. And Hunter is not unique. Every single Wonder Lab staff person has reinvented their jobs over and over again during the shutdown time, and I could not be more proud of each and every one of you. So, wherever you are out there, Wonder Lab staff, stand up, 3 cheers to you. And I can't go any farther tonight without thanking our amazing gala committee, whose creativity and tireless work brought this event to us tonight. So, I'll start with Megan Rothrock, our gala chairperson. Going on, there's Asha Kirchhoff, Ashley Johnson, Caitlin Keller, Carly Fields, Dion Cross Francis, Amy Osajima, and Megan Thompson. Stand up wherever you are, three cheers for you. Wonder Lab is also really fortunate to have an engaged and dedicated board of directors, many of whom are out there somewhere this evening. So I hope you will all raise a glass to all of these remarkable people. Thank you all.
Underneath a tight turn, it's one more tight corner. Molly has to pry herself up. She can see the bell. She needs to ring to finish. As she gets closer to the top, one stretch, and Molly has done it. Molly Kate, congratulations.
Before I want to introduce this evening's speaker, I want to be sure and thank our generous sponsors. And I hope that you all will too when you're out and about in the community. They are Herla Wealth Management Group, Slotograf Niehoff, Old National Bank, First Insurance Group, Liberty Farm Dentistry, Lauren Wood Builders, BKD CPAs and Advisors, Bloomington Oral Surgery, Boston Scientific, Commercial Service, Dr. K. Luke Eads Family Dentistry, FC Tucker Bloomington Realty, Innovative Financial Solutions, Quality Mills Supply, Bill C. Brown Associates, Blue and Company, LLC, Sterling Lab, from the very beginning, and the importance of making science fun and memorable. At Wonder Lab's very first gala many years ago, he put the mayor of Bloomington on a bed of real nails and broke a concrete block over his chest to demonstrate the physical principles of force and pressure. Everyone was fine. Rick led a team of undergraduate students to create and install a cosmic ray telescope at the new Wonder Lab, and that's still working today. Rick has remained a popular presenter at Wonder Lab's teacher workshops over the last 15 years. He's been a longtime friend, an advocate for Wonder Lab, and is currently on our board of directors. So, I'm now going to turn it over to Rick, who's going to tell you about rumbling resonances from spooky hauntings to Lotus Fest.
Hi, I'm Rick Van Kooten. I'm a physics professor at Indiana University Bloomington. I'm also the executive dean of the College of Arts and Sciences. That's my day job now. My research is normally in experimental particle physics, so working at these gigantic facilities, first outside of Chicago, Fermilab, and then now at outside of Geneva, Switzerland, smashing particles together and see what happens. I've also for quite a few times taught the physics of sound in the department. And as a result of it, I've had a lot of undergrads working on small tabletop experiments, like very different from my main line of research, in acoustics. And so I've also sort of developed a hobby of acoustics and being interested in sound. So I'll be talking about today sound very quickly in general, and also talking about resonances and how they lead to these very two different disparate topics of hauntings and what you might hear in a given year at Lotus Fest. I'm going to talk and discuss sound in tubes or in columns of air. For example, if I have this tube and I bop it on the end, the sound it makes.
This is an animation where the points or the dots represent either an air molecule or a patch of air. I'm going to provide a pulse just like we did at the beginning where we bopped the tube. And you can see an area of compression or higher pressure followed by an area of what's called rarefaction where the air molecules are spread further apart. That's a sound pulse traveling at the speed of sound down the tube. Now, this animation shows that we can excite the tube or sound in the tube by a smoothly varying sinusoidal excitation. And you can see in the top, again, a wave, sound waves moving down the tube. Now, talking about the concept of resonance, a classic example is pushing a swing. If you push a swing just at the right frequency, every time they come back, you push it. And if you keep pushing it at the right time, the right frequency, you hit a resonance and your child goes higher and higher and higher and giggles with glee. Now you could think of the same way of a resonance in a tube. For example, if you have a sound pulse going back and I hit it at just the right time, bop, 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 that sound pulse will keep getting louder and louder and louder. And so you've excited a resonance. And the frequency at which you have to slap the tube is essentially how long it takes to get the end of the tube and back, the speed of sound and air there and back. Now, as the tube gets longer, the frequency, the length of time it gets there and back is longer and longer. So the longer the tube, the lower the pitch of the resonance. Now, when you hit resonance, the oscillations of the air molecules look like this. And we want to consider this for when we look at different types of resonance a little bit later. A great example of this are the giant xylopipes in Wonder Lab. You can see that these are pipes of different length, and the longer ones have lower pitches, the shorter ones have higher pitches, so one can play a song. And the same is true of organ pipes. Now, the range of frequency of hearing for adults is roughly between 30 hertz and some like 15,000 to 16,000 hertz. Any sound below around 30 hertz is not perceived as a tone. It's, you know, it's a vibration, it's still a sound wave, but it sort of vibrates parts of your body. And there's a lot of evidence that vibrations or sound infrasound at these frequencies make you feel uneasy. And a very interesting experiment was done in the UK where scientists in a concert hall in the basement had a long sewer pipe, 66 meters long, where they drove it with a subwoofer to get a resonance, like I showed before, of 17.4 hertz. The resonance provided a very high level of this sound. And what they would do is that they'd have controls where they wouldn't play this tone and have a concert upstairs. And it was very upbeat music. And they would actually survey the people, ask them, how did the music make you feel? And there's a lot of reports, made them happy, made them cheerful. And then sort of random concerts, they would turn on the 17.4 hertz and do the same thing, give them the survey, ask how it made them feel. And they would report again, these sensations of feeling uneasy, that the hairs on the back of their neck would stand up. They'd feel chills down their spine. They'd just feel nervous looking around at what was going on. They perceived the music differently because of these sensations. What is interesting is that also in the largest cathedrals have gigantic pipe organs that actually have pipes long enough to produce notes of 16 hertz. And there's also evidence that when you're listening to music or organ music in these gigantic cathedrals and they're playing these very low notes, again, you're not hearing them as a tone, you also get sensations which are unusual. And it can be open to interpretation. And sometimes people have spiritual feelings in the presence of such infrasound. And this leads us to the next, you know, where the purported hauntings in some cases. There in fact been numerous cases of infrasound being responsible for what people thought were hauntings, including this peer-reviewed study in this journal article by Vic Tandy. In that case, it was a 19 hertz infrasound that was pervading actually this laboratory where the scientist was working on and was trying to investigate what was the source of this, where there is a unbalanced fan that was resonating in this long corridor and that people working there was driving them nuts because, again, just sensory phenomena that particularly when they're late at night, they would actually have sensations that they thought of in the presence of a ghost. There's also this interesting where there's resonance of different parts of your body. Your lungs resonate at low frequencies. A really classic one is your eyeball will resonate at around 19 hertz. It's filled with liquid, so it's even though it's small, it resonates at low frequencies. And when you vibrate an eye like that, sometimes you get gray images off to the side that people have interpreted as ghosts. So that long corridors being excited by the wind blowing past an open window, again, exciting a resonance in a hallway where if people stood at a certain place, they'd feel chills. Again, think it's a ghost, but it was really infrasound. Now there are different ways to set up resonances inside of tubes. We already have seen this top one called the fundamental. Now there's more complicated patterns of frequencies that will also provide resonances in a tube in this case, which is open on both ends. And I'll show an animation. The top one is the fundamental, which is what you get if you bop the tube that I showed previously. And you can see more complicated patterns that also will resonate in that same tube. What's interesting is that they'll be at frequencies which are exact multiples of the fundamental. So twice this one, you can sort of see that it's this one's going back and forth at twice the frequency and this one at three times the frequency. And in general, when you have a sound, you have a complex sound. You have all these different resonances and harmonics at the same time. Now let's analyze a very distinctive sound, like pouring yourself a tall, cold glass of beer. So the water column goes up. As it goes up, the air column above it, it's like the equivalent of a pipe, getting shorter and shorter. And so that you hear the frequency go up in pitch as the cylinder fills up. Now we're gonna analyze it using a spectrogram shown here. And birders may be familiar with these. They'd often use that to show the characteristic trilling or warbling of a bird. What it is along this horizontal axis is time. This is about 8 seconds. And this vertical axis is frequency from 0 to 4,000 hertz. So where you see a band indicates an enhancement of that frequency or a resonance. And the fact that you see these different bands regularly spaced shows those harmonics, those multiples of frequencies as you go up. And as you can see, the frequencies go up from that sound. So let's play the sound on this from that previous filling up yourself a cold beer. So now what we're getting at is the last topic, and that's if you're at Lotus Fest and you see somebody actually throat singing. And what this involves is that there's a column of air above your vocal cords that actually provide a very buzzy sound. And vowels and your whole speech mechanism has to do with various orientations or changing of this column of air above the vocal cords. There's your pharynx, the oral cavity. This opens up and then actually you can have resonances in your nasal cavity. An example of this is showing just saying the vowel ah. So when you're saying ah, this closes off and you get different lengths, you get different resonances in your vocal tract. Every two or three years at the Lotus Festival, there's usually a group that headlines at least one or more throat singers. It's part of the culture of Tuva, a country just north of Mongolia and parts of Mongolia, where they spend decades learning how to do this, the singing. And I'm gonna show you a snippet of Siget throat singing style. And I was very, very excited as looking up the schedule for this this coming virtual Lotus Festival. There's this group, Hun Her Tu, which features somebody who does this very, very well. I'm gonna play this and I wanna emphasize, this is only this one person singing, no instruments, no accompanying instruments, is that they are able to control their vocal tract in such a way that they can dampen the fundamental. You hear something very guttural, that's the fundamental, and then really emphasize the higher harmonics, the fifth, sixth, or seventh harmonics. What you'll hear is a flute-like sound that is not an instrument, it's his voice. And sometimes it's called polyphonic singing for that reason. Let's take a look of a spectrogram of a different snippet of SIGET's singing. You will see again, this is time, this is frequency. You can see these really strong bands, which are those flute-like sounds shown here and here, and then even at these very, very high frequencies above 5,000 hertz. This goes up to 8,000 hertz. You'll see hardly any of the fundamental and a lot of power intensity in these. And actually, when I'm at these live Lotus Fest performances, I'm often sitting with my phone, you know, looking at the spectrum as they're singing. Just my wife rolls her eyes, but I really do get a kick out of this. You can track the melody going up and down, down, up again. And now we're going to go and just look at this one snippet where it's kind of constant sound. And we're going to analyze the frequency in that snippet. So here are the different peaks. And we're going to just play that single frequency. Turn up your volume if you can. The second peak. Now really crank your volume. This one's really hard to hear. Okay, you may not have heard that last one. So with that, I hope you enjoyed these little tidbits driven by resonance and the science of acoustics. And thank you very much for having me, and enjoy the rest of your science night in. Take care. Be healthy.
And now it is time for our climber number two in the Grapevine Challenge. Molly Kate stands about 4 feet tall, but Dr. Bryce McKee is about 6 feet tall. Let's see how the doctor can navigate Grapevine Challenge number two in 3, 2, 1. Dr. McKee, let's see it. He is moving his way up on his belly. The first turn's a very tough turn, but the doctor, who is a skinny doctor, that's the good news, he's fighting his way up. He's going to have to twist and turn a little bit because some of these turns aren't for big folks. He is now on his back, finds his way to his knees, pulling through the mesh wires and up to the top. Molly Kate went in 44. Can the doctor beat it? He can see the finish line from here, but he has some twists and turns left to go. Are you breathing heavy, Doc? He has two masks on. That has to count for something. The bell is right around the corner. He looks like a snake. Are you a snake doctor? A snake charmer? He sees the bell and rings it. And that is contestant number two.
I'm Kyle Adams, and I'm joined by Gabe Lubell, and today we're going to talk to you a little bit about the workings of and the physics behind this curious and quirky little instrument. So, I'll start off just by telling you a little bit about how sound is made on the theremin. The actual mechanism of playing the instrument is pretty straightforward. We have a vertical antenna over here, and we have a horizontal antenna coming out over here. You can't see this right now, but it's actually a loop. This antenna controls the pitch, so the closer I get to it, the higher the pitch gets, and vice versa. The antenna over here controls the volume. The closer I get to the volume antenna, the more the volume goes down to zero. So louder and softer. So that's the basic mechanism of playing the theremin.
Now those basic mechanics tie to one of two important physical phenomena that actually generate the sound. So this first effect that's related to the distance between the antenna interacts with an electronic phenomenon called capacitance. Capacitance deals with the kind of storing up of electrical charge within two separate physical objects. So in the case of the theremin, each antenna acts as one part of a capacitor. The hand acts as a moving part, a moving second part of the capacitor. And what happens is that the instrument creates an electrical charge inside the antenna. And then as the hand moves closer, the antenna kind of induces a charge in the hand. And how much of a charge it induces depends on how close or far away the hand is from the antenna. So moving the hand, therefore, kind of changes the information that's received on the inside of the instrument. The higher or lower the capacitance based on the separation of the antenna or the hand gives the instrument something to use in order to then generate sound. Now, how it actually creates the sound is another story. There's some other electrical phenomena that go on inside the instrument that are necessary to take that pure capacitance information and translate it into musical sound. But before we get into that, Kyle, why don't you tell us a little bit more about how you actually think musically about these interactions?
Yeah, so the way that I tend to think of the instrument is I imagine that there's a string, like a violin string, extending from the pitch antenna all the way across my body to the left. And just like a violin string, the closer I get to the antenna, the higher the pitch gets, just like you get with a violin bridge, right? It's also the case that the closer you get to the antenna, the closer the notes get to one another. So it means that playing high on the theremin requires a very, very high degree of control, of physical control. So one of the things that string players have learned, and I've learned this too on the theremin, is that you can mask a lot of the pitch difficulty through the use of vibrato. So I'm going to put my hand in the electrical field, and you notice that no matter how steady I try to keep my hand, the pitch is going to vary quite a bit. So it doesn't look like I'm moving, but you hear fluctuations in pitch. So I can mask those a little bit by, just like the human voice or a violin uses vibrato. And of course, to play repeated notes at all, you need to lift your hand off the volume and put it back again. So you can't just repeat a note unless you physically stop the sound with the volume loop. Something like that. So that's the basic mechanism of playing the instrument.
Now, on the inside, in order to actually generate the sound, you need another electrical phenomenon, and that's the phenomenon of inductance. The basic idea of inductance is that if you run an electrical current through, say, a coiled wire, it will actually create a magnetic field that has the effect of kind of dampening down the flow of electricity. So it turns out that when you attach a capacitor, like you have with the hands and the antennas, to an inductor, the two can actually work together to create this kind of ebb and flow of electricity in one direction and then in the other. So you would say build up charge in the capacitor, and while you're building up charge in the capacitor, that affects the inductor that then wants to kind of draw the charge in the opposite direction. But drawing it in the opposite direction turns the capacitor back on and makes it want to do what it wants to do. So putting these two things together, you start to get a cycling system where electricity moves back and forth between the inductor and the capacitor, back and forth over and over again. Now, anytime we have something that operates in this kind of flip-flopping periodic way, that makes us think of waves. And it turns out that a wave in electronics behaves basically the same way as a wave does in sound, right? In physics, a wave is a wave is a wave. So between these two fairly basic electrical concepts, you have a way of creating something periodic. The problem, though, is that the frequency of the waves we get from the basic capacitor and inductor don't happen within the range of human hearing. So you need some other electronics on the inside of the instrument to actually then turn it into sound. Now, that electronics becomes like really complicated, and there are a number of ways of actually doing that exercise of transferring the frequency range. But it turns out that that specific process of transposing the frequency into the audible range is what gives the theremin its actual sound. That's what gives it the characteristic qualities that we've come to associate with it. It's kind of, you know, ethereal, detached kind of a sound. It's all happening as a sort of magical process inside the instrument.
It's a lot like the human voice in that there is no observable physical relationship between pitches, right? So I don't know from here where the next note is going to be. So there are a lot of variables that go into the sound, and one really has to use one's ear even to play something as simple as a scale. So that was not a terribly good scale from me because I don't have a lot of experience on the instrument. But this kind of thing really makes you appreciate all of the work, all of the internal work that our brain does and our ear does just to produce a steady set of pitches.
And I think that that idea of this being an instrument that draws your attention to what goes on in the mind, in the imagination, has also been part of the fascination from composers and how they have used this instrument. So it's not a particularly common instrument in classical music, but every time it has been used, it's been used to kind of convey these ideas, this idea of music coming from technology, music coming from the mind and imagination. And this is part of why, where it's found maybe its most welcome home has been in soundtracks and the world of sci-fi and fantasy, precisely because it kind of interacts with you know, sort of the action of the imagination, right? It's not something you have to touch. It's something that you can just sort of use your mind to sort of induce into the world or out of it as it may be. So Kyle, why don't you do that for us? Take us away.
I'll take us home with the sound of a UFO taking off into the deepest recesses of space here. So.
And speaking of climbing, it'll be our third and final contestant on the Grapevine Challenge tonight. Molly Kate started us off at 45 seconds. The Doc, Bryce McKee, went at 44 seconds. And now it is the horse for the course, the leprous, if you will, Ella Heckman. Ella, how many times have you climbed the Grapevine? Hundreds. The pressure is on, just like the Kentucky Derby last Saturday, the biggest favorite in 31 years. You don't feel any pressure. We'll count it down. 3, 2, 1, and away she goes. 44 seconds is the number to beat, and she is moving adroitly through the Grapevine Challenge. She is already halfway to it, slinking and snaking her way. No shoes, no problem. As she moves up, she's skipping stages. This is not her first time, folks, as she mentioned, as she crawls under and over, and one more turn for home, and down the stretch she comes. Ella rings the bell. We'll have to check our time to see who the fastest climber was tonight in the Grapevine Challenge.
Hi everybody, I hope you're enjoying Science Night In. My name is Asha, I work as an engineer at Cook Medical, and I also serve on the board of directors at Wonder Lab. I first got involved with Wonder Lab a few years ago when I started volunteering at STEM Sundays. I think STEM Sundays are a great example of what Wonder Lab does so well, which is take a science or engineering concept and make it simple and fun through a hands-on activity. When Wonder Lab closed its doors due to the pandemic in March, STEM Sunday continued online in a virtual format, and I was so impressed and inspired by how the magic of science and engineering continued using simple household materials. So I was inspired by that to do a little at-home science with you tonight. And of course, we're going to focus on the science of sound. So, at its most basic level, sound is a wave, and that wave is governed by one very simple equation: frequency is equal to velocity divided by wavelength. So Frequency is probably the thing we interact with most with sound because it's what we hear. It's the beautiful melody you sing along to. It's what you start manipulating when you're playing an instrument. On the other side of the equation, we have velocity. And this is actually very simple. It is the speed of sound through air. And so that's going to be a constant because, well, we're always hearing sound through air. Then we're going to divide that velocity by wavelength. Wavelength is where it gets interesting. So imagine a wave, if you will, and wavelength is the distance between the peaks of that wave. Now, let's say you have a big, long wave. You're going to have a large distance between your peaks, so you're going to have a large wavelength value. And when you divide the speed of sound through air by that large value, you're going to get a low value as your frequency. And then you're going to get a low pitch, a low note that you hear. Now, on the opposite side, let's imagine a really short wave. So that is going to have short little distances between peaks, and therefore you're going to have a small wavelength value. So again, divide velocity of sound through air by a small value. Now you're going to get a large number for your frequency. You're going to get a high frequency, which means a high note. Now, I hope that this mathematically makes sense, but don't worry because we're actually going to see it. Let's build a slide whistle. And so you can manipulate wavelength on your own and see how it affects frequency. So what I want you to do is dig into the goodie box you got from WonderLab, and inside there's going to be a brown paper bag that has a couple components in that. And we're gonna look at what those are, starting with a piece of 3/4 inch PVC pipe, a 3/4 inch wooden dowel rod, a PVC connector piece, a short little wooden dowel piece with some tape at the end, a little foam circle that has double stick tape on one side, and then finally a little piece of wax paper with some tape on it. So to begin building our whistle, start with the PVC pipe. This is going to form the body of our whistle, and at one end you see that there's a channel cut out, and that's where our mouthpiece goes. So take your short little wooden block with the tape and insert it tape end first into where that channel is, and only push it up until the tape. Then, take your PVC connector piece and slide it on top. And now, let's see if this makes a noise. Okay, I don't know what yours sounds like, but mine sounds a little weak. We could make this sound better. So I'm gonna take off the connector, and I'm gonna take off the wooden dowel, and you'll notice this is pretty loose. I can turn it, and that means it's not tight enough. This needs to be really tight and form an airtight seal. So to fix that, I'm gonna remove this piece, take my piece of wax paper and peel off the tape, and wrap this around just, you know, until the tape is gone. There we go. And now this should have a tighter fit. Yes, it is a lot tighter. It's actually hard for me to insert now, and that's perfect. So again, I'm inserting to the depth of the tape. Nice and tight seal, does not rotate around. And then I'm taking my PVC connector piece and sliding it on top. When I do that, I'm making sure that the edge of the PVC connector comes down to just about the edge of where the tape ends. I want those to be at about the same place. All right, so I look like I did that. Let's try it again. Okay, that sounds much better now. So let's turn this normal whistle into a sliding whistle. Take your piece of foam and peel off the double stick tape. And then choose any end of your wooden dowel and stick the foam on. Try to make sure it's nice and centered, just like that. And then this is going to act as our plunger. So go ahead and stick this foam piece through the other end of your whistle. And you should feel that be able to slide nice and smoothly and easily inside. And now we'll test if this works as a slide whistle. Awesome. And now you see we've proven the relationship between wavelength and frequency. When I stick my slide plunger all the way out here, this entire length of the whistle is available for the sound to resonate. And that means I'm setting a longer wavelength. So again, I'm gonna get that low frequency note. If I move the slide whistle up, I'm setting a shorter length, a shorter wavelength, and now I'm gonna get that higher frequency. And now you see how that works. So now you have a fun whistle that you can play around with to see the relationship between frequency and wavelength. This is something you can experiment with at home, see what songs you can make up, maybe even build it in different PVC lengths. So I hope that you have fun with this activity. I hope that you learned a little bit more about the science of sound. And I just want to say thank you so much for your support of WonderLab. Have a good rest of your night.
The thing I like most about science is that science can help us understand the mysteries of the world. And it can help us, find a way to cure this pandemic. And why science is important is because without science, everyone would just be, well, you know, dumb.
I like science because it's everything, and because I like space and rockets.
Hi, my name is Arya, and I wanted to share what I love about science. I like science because I get to learn stuff that I didn't know. And I also like the Wonder Lab because it's just so cool, and there's like the magnetic water and like the parachute thing. And I like to catch the parachutes. And I also like the building thing that you can build it with screws. And you have the hats. And I also like when you grab the block with a crane and you put it on top of another one. Bye.
Greetings from my home to you in your home. Hope you're enjoying tonight. I wanted to talk about why the Wonder Lab is meaningful to me. I started my relationship with the Wonder Lab actually as a volunteer in the museum. Upon moving to Bloomington, I knew nobody and was looking for something to do. And I had attended a Wonder Lab gala, and I thought it was wonderful, and it piqued my interest, and it seemed like it was really a staple in the community. And so I met Jean and Diane, and if you know them, then you know exactly how wonderful they are and how great they are at making the museum a place that is inviting for young people to volunteer and also for young people to attend. And that was a little home away from home. I felt really welcomed. I learned a lot. It's amazing what kid science will teach you and remind you of things that you learned so long ago, and some new things too. And from then, I went on to become a CASA, and that was a little heavier, working with children who are at risk of being abused or neglected. And the Wonder Lab in that case was always a place where you could see kids bloom, where they would open up and they would get to be free. They would get to play and they would get to use their mind and explore. And it was really, really wonderful, such a gift. As time passed, I had my own children, and that's something that I really wish for them, to have the freedom to be creative, to explore, to experiment, to fail, to succeed, to keep persevering. And I think that's born out of a curious spirit and a sense of wonder. And that's something that the Wonder Lab provides. I see it in my own children. I see it on field trips. I'm looking forward to going back on field trips as soon as possible when it's safe to do so. It's just a wonderful place. It's a treasure that we have in our community and an opportunity that I think is so important for kids of all ages and socioeconomic levels to be able to attend. And that's a reason that my husband Gavin and I feel so strongly about donating our dollars every year, because it supports something that's meaningful and tangible and beloved. I hope you'll join me
tonight in supporting Wonder Lab and raising some funds for something that is totally Bloomington and wonderful.
Thank you, everyone. This has been an amazing event. Whew, and I feel like it's not over yet. There's donations still coming in, and we're tracking those to see what our final total is for the evening. Thank you all for your generosity. Before I sign off, I just want to say a special thank you to everyone who made all of the different parts come together here, and that is Deirdre, Beth, Hunter, Rick, Asha, and Adam for all of your parts in making this event happen. So tonight we made, it's coming up on $30,000, and there'll be some additional monies coming in, so cross your fingers that we can meet that match. The donation link is still live. We're really hoping to get that huge $50,000 match contribution, so please help us get there. One more thing, and that is that if you won one of tonight's auction items, Wonder Lab will be in touch with you to arrange a delivery that works for you. So now, have a wonderful rest of your evening. Thank you so much, and good night.